Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome to today's web conference, Finance and Operations Tech Talk. Today's topic is data management. My name is AJ and I'm going to be your moderator today. We are broadcasting this web conference through Teams live events and the audio can be heard through your PC speakers. Today's web conference is being recorded on behalf of the Microsoft Corporation. Participation in the meeting today indicates your consent to being included in the meeting recording. Attendees may access the web conference recording via the same registration link that was used to attend today's live broadcast. If you have questions for the presenters or need support, you can use the Q&A panel located on the right-hand side of your screen. Our presenters will be responding to your questions during the presentation. Presenting for us today from Microsoft, we have Mark, Senior R&D Solution Architect, and helping with the Q&A, we have Eric, Senior R&D Solution Architect. Mark, you now have the floor.
Welcome, everybody. If we start talking about data management, then typically the kind of questions that are popping up is, how can I plan a configuration? What tools and frameworks do I have available to manage data? How can I optimize the data migration process, improve speed, making sure that if I'm loading data, I get the right performance? How can I move a configuration if I'm, for instance, have created a template company, how can I copy that configurations to whatever new legal entity I'm going to add to my environment? And of course, questions like, how can I share data across legal entities? These are all valid questions. Unfortunately, there is no that simple answer to it. And there is a lot of things that we need to consider. So basically, we need to understand what kind of scenario we are talking about. Do we are we talking about data migration from legacy systems, for instance, old AX2009 or AX2012, or foreign systems, or are we talking about doing a new brand new implementation and we're starting with an initial blank environment and we're going to add an initial configuration to that? Of course, if we're talking about making a new, brand new configuration, then we could basically either just start typing in all the parameters into an environment. But we do know that we will have multiple environments during our project. We will have training environments, we will have performance environments, we might have separate environment for migration. So of course, we do not want to type in that configuration over and over manually. We expect that you would be having a golden configuration where you would maintain your parameters and basically you would be able to copy the configuration to the other environments. And there are different techniques for that. We could either just copy the full database, but of course, if we're talking about phased go-lives, then copying the database is something that we can only do the first for the first go-live. And then afterwards, for the next implementations, we will have to do an export of data packages and importing the configuration via the data package into the destination company. If we're talking about copying databases, there is different needs for it. For instance, if you are live already and you encounter a serious problem and just looking into the telemetry and via the user interface doesn't give us sufficient answers and we need to go a little bit deeper and be able to either have access to the SQL or just being able to debug the source code, then we need to be able to take a copy of that database to a sandbox and then having more access to it available. Other things we might consider is, do we want to share data across legal entities? Should it be available for all legal entities in the environment? Or do we want to have it set up for some legal entities? So, and other thing that we can be doing is, or asked for is copying and company configuration within an existing environment. So depending on what kind of data management scenario we're talking, we will have to use different techniques. Another thing that we need to be aware of as well is depending what in kind of activity we're doing, we might end up with different kind of environments. So if we're talking about developing, then typically we're talking about a tier one environment, and a tier one environment will be using a local deployment of SQL, while any tier two or higher environment basically will just have either some VMs for AOSs, or if we're using the new architecture, just some IIS services for AOS, but they will be connecting to Azure SQL as a service. And depending on what kind of environment we're having, the the tools that we're going to use are different. So that's quite important to understand that we need to know what kind of scenarios we're talking about, and we need to know what kind of environments we're talking about. And then, of course, the step is to make sure that we are aware of all the possibilities. So this tech talk today will go on high level about the three main things that we're having for data management. First one is our data management import-export framework. That's the tool that we're going to use when we are trying to copy one legal entity or the setup from one legal entity to another. We will be discussing templates, an easy way of making sure that you can move configuration either to another, exported from one environment and imported into another environment, or just copy it within the legal entity. Second part of this tech talk will talk about the database operations. So we do have a possibility for making a backup of an environment. We can restore that backup. We can ask a refresh, which is basically copying over the data from another environment over the existing one. Or we can ask for a point in time restore. It's just a kind of an rollback where we will be going back and just moving the database to the time that has been selected. We must make it a little bit different there, whether we're going to do that on a production database or for the tier two environments. But basically, all those things or all those tools are available via LCS. And then the last topic will be a little bit about the data sharing framework, which is introduced now also into finance and operation. We could definitely cannot compare it to, or should not think that it's an equivalent for what we have in the past as virtual companies, but it allows us to synchronize data and make sure that data is in sync between legal entities. So let's go to the first topic, the data management import-export. You probably all know that we are going to find the data management workspace and the data inside finance and operations. And that basically is the workspace which allows us to do whatever is necessary. So we can easily create import projects, export projects. If we want to set up templates, we're going to do that. We can make use of data task automation, copy into legal entity. So all the features that are available for data management will be found here in this workspace. The data migration framework, or the import export framework, is used, of course, for data migrations, and it's a core component of data migration. But we need to understand that it's not only used for data migrations. It's used in a lot of scenarios. We're going to use it when we are defining integrations, if we're going to make data available for business intelligence, we're going to use that framework. Mobile applications will be accessing the data via this framework. If we're going to move configuration configurations from one environment to another, we're going to use this framework, Office integrations, and whatever external application that needs to have access to data in finance and operations will have to use the framework. Framework is based on entities. And basically, an entity is something that was introduced for making sure that you are not necessarily need to know how data has been stored into the database. If we're looking to the earlier versions, AX3, AX4, AX2009, at that moment, the database was quite simple. And if we were looking for some data regarding customers, we could find almost everything in the CUS table. Having such a flat database structure is, of course, quite good for understanding everything, but it makes it complicated or it makes it impossible for having good performance. And for good performance, you need to make sure that your data is normalized. So you must make sure that if you don't have duplicates into your data structure. So for instance, if you use an address that can be used for multiple customers, instead of putting the address into the customer table, you will be putting it into a separate table, and then from the customer table, you would only have a pointer to the record in the address table. And since AX2012, the database for finance and operations has been normalized quite heavily, which makes it more and more complex for external applications to retrieve data or to insert data in that. And the data entity basically is the concept that we're going to use to avoid that. And what we're going to do is we're going to denormalize and we're going to present the data to the external application again in a logical view. So if we're talking about the customer entity, you will also find its the addresses that are related to it in the same entity. By doing that, we're going to make a kind of abstraction and we're going to do encapsulation, but we need to understand also that it means that we have giving up on performance. And I'm coming back on that later, because if we use the out-of-the-box standard entities, we might have some performance issues or performance challenges for importing large data sets. And it might be that we will have to do something in development for making more performant entities which are fulfilling those needs. So if we're looking, the entity itself is the base entity and basically is already an aggregation of information which is typically coming from different tables. If we're looking into finance and operations, the latest version, then we have more than 3,000 data entities already defined. So if we need to move data from one legal entity to another or from one environment to another, and we will have to do that entity by entity, then we're talking about a huge manual task. So what we have done then is we have made packages which are basically going to aggregate data entities together, which are making logical components. If you look into standard finance and operations, you will see that we have defined somewhere around 250 data packages. But even then, if we're talking of moving data with data packages from one legal entity to another, still managing 250 packages is too complex. And we have added, therefore, a new concept, which is called a template. And basically, a template will be a combination with data packages. If you would have your own entities that you have been defined yourself, you could add them into your template. And basically, either if you are a partner, then typically as a partner, you would be looking for specific industries, and you might have been defining a package which is tuned for a retail customer, or you might have a packages created for manufacturing customers or process manufacturing customers. So there is different reasons why as a partner you would define your own templates. But also as customer, I think it makes sense definitely if you have a phased go live and you know that all your companies will be using the same kind of configuration, then it makes sense for from the beginning create your own template and then make sure that you populate all your data via your own designed template. Okay, now that we have the basic concepts, we need to look a little bit what are we going to do if we're talking about high volume. And for that, in the data management, we do have under the framework parameters, we have some settings that we need to look into. First one that I'm going to talk about is the entity execution parameters. And if you deploy a new environment, that environment basically will have a blank form for that, meaning that for all entities, if there is nothing defined, then it means all entities. We're going to start, we don't have any import threshold, and it means that we will be importing all entities in a single threaded. So if we want to have multi-threading imports, the first thing we need to do is we must make sure that we were going to set up some thresholds. Parallelism only makes sense if you have large volumes. So typically you would then see entries starting if I want to import more than 50 customers, I'm going to use two tasks instead of the default one task. And basically for an entity, we can define multiple thresholds. So in this case, for customers, if we present a data import file less than 50, it will be single threaded. From 50 till 499, it will using two threads. And if we're going above 500, then we're going to use five threads. Those threads, of course, we must make sure that we have, if we're asking threads, that they are available. And therefore, we need to look in the system administration setup server configuration. And there, typically, you will see how many threads are available per AOS. During data migration, using a lot of threads typically will help making sure that you get your data uploaded in a decent time. Be careful with it. This bundling is only working if you're using the batch framework. So if you would just interactively upload the file via the user interface, those bundling parameters will have no influence at all. It's only when we are running through the batch framework that we will be seeing the advantage of it. If bundling doesn't give us sufficient information, then the next step for optimizing is looking to find or to use the entities which are using set-based operations. If we're going into the standard finance and operations and we're going to the screen where we see all the entities and we would select on those who have set-based selected, you will see actually that we don't have that many available. Reason for it is that it needs to be needs to be designed using the right methods. So you need to to look into some methods for the entity. And instead of using the insert record, update record, delete record, you will see that you need to use their functions like insert record set, update record set. And that, of course, will give a huge performance increase because instead of having to have a communication between the AOS and the Azure SQL on a record by level, record by record level, you're really going to give to pass the data in bulk to the Azure SQL, reducing all the latency that you have between AOS and Azure SQL, and getting huge performance increase. Of course, you can ask why don't you have that done for all the entities? There are some caveats on it. So as soon as you have a method on the insert on a table, typically an insert record set will degrade to an insert record because you need to call that method on a record bar, a record level. So it is not always possible for having set-based operations, and it means that in some circumstances, if you really are talking of high volumes of data that needs to be interfaced in short terms, that you might consider of developing your own entities, which then can skip the insert methods and running those things after you have first imported your data into a staging table. Besides the bundling and the set-based operations, which are coming out of the box, at least for some entities such as fixed assets or ledger journals, the next step that you might have to look into if you don't have if the time that you need for uploading your data is too high for the time that you have been getting for doing the migration is looking into an incremental migration. So of course that means that your migration process becomes a little bit more complex, and it means that you need to have a bulk of data which is not changing any longer. But typically if you would say I'm going to export, if you have a large amount of customers or a large amount of products, I'm going to export them a week before go live. And then just during the go live weekend, I'm going just needed to do the deltas, the ones which has been created and modified in the last week. That's all kind of things that will help you in making sure that you can upload within a time frame, a given time frame, the necessary data. As I mentioned earlier, for it might be that if you have specific scenarios that you will have to rewrite some of the entities so that they are really are tuned for performance and for your customer scenario. The last step is, of course, that during the migration, because typically in that period, you will have a huge amount of data that you want to upload, and it might be that afterwards you don't need that performance any longer. For that, it is possible that during the go live preparation, we give you an environment which is scaled out. Be careful with that. We see a lot of people thinking that if you have a performance issue, that it's sufficient for just adding some more hardware. This is not the case. Typically, if you see that an AOS thread is slow, just by adding more AOSs, that process, if it's not using multi-threading, will still be slow. So the first thing is you must make sure that you have already the bundling enabled. You must have looked into the fact if you didn't need the set-based operations instead before actually you can start asking for an environment which is scaled up, and make sure that you start thinking about uploading in parallel way before the go live weekend, because this is not something that you can just easily do and assume that it will be working without some tuning needed. So the key of all of this is, yes, it is possible, but it needs some planning. And if you start doing migration of data for configurations, you need to plan for it, and you must make sure that you start early enough. What we have for helping you with that is the templates. And basically what the templates will be helping you is making sure that you can import into the right order. We have a lot of entities. Some of the entities will be depending on data which is in other entities. So it is important that we know what kind of sequence we're going to use. So for that, The framework will help us making sure that we couldn't do auto sequences. Also, you will see the way we have delivering our templates. There is a kind of a numbering schema besides, and it will help you already identifying what kind of packages are depending on each other. All that will help you making sure that you can do your migrations using data packages, and that you can do it also for complex integration scenarios. If you're looking into sequencing, there are actually three levels. We have the execution unit, which is the highest level. And if if data is in a different execution unit, there can be no dependencies. So execution units will always be executed in parallel. Within the execution level, within the execution unit, we do have the next step is levels. And if we have level one, level two, level three, it means that we first will do everything within level one before we start executing level two. So the levels will really be executed in sequence. Within a level, you still have the possibility for defining a sequence, and then all the packages which are in the same sequence will be executed in parallel. And then if all the packages for level one have been finished, we will for sequence one, we will move to sequence one, sequence two, and from sequence two to sequence three. Besides that, for each of those steps, we also will have to define what happens if one of those data packages would fail. And we have two options for that. Either we will say that it will fail the entire execution, or it will just fail the level. This is the kind of thing that we're expecting that you will be setting up into your template. So you would be seeing your execution unit, you would be seeing your level in execution, and you would be seeing the sequence. So you will find them here, execution unit, level in execution, sequence. Typically, we would not expect, although, as you can see, you could create your template and you could add entity by entity. And that might be the case if you have your own tables, you want to make a template for your own data entities, you could do it entity by entity. But we're expecting that you will be start using one of the templates, the default templates that are coming available. So if you click on load default templates, you will see the list of all templates that are available and can be immediately imported into your environment. In the past, we have been publishing that as LCS in the LCS asset library. You still can download them from there and upload them, but the most recent one can be get via the load default template. And as you can see, they will be getting an execution unit and an already a level and sequence. If you want to change that, you can resequence them. And you can easily move your templates by doing the import export template and import template into another environment. If you're planning for configurations, you really need to think about not only your first, your main legal entity, but you should also think about what will happen if I create in a phased go live, what should I be doing for my next legal entity? Should that entity be imported, or will it become available because I'm using data sharing, either the cross-company data sharing, or it might be a shared table in my finance and operation. But it is important that we have a plan for that and we know what data needs to be imported, what data is already available. And we really ask everybody to make sure that he makes this kind of this plan before he starts into the go live weekends. And of course, the plan should not only be created, it should also be executed a couple of times at least, making sure that for all of these tasks, we know how long it will take. And if we're adding up all those times, that we're sure that we're still in the within the time that is assigned for the go live. So what is a template? Actually, a data template, you could actually see it as a grouping from multiple data packages, but you're not putting in the data. So it's really a framework making sure that you have all the configurations that you want to move from one environment to another. So we can export that template, you can import it into another environment, so you can absolutely make sure that all your environments are using the same template. There is a possibility for validating your configuration, so seeing that there is not dependencies which are missing. We can see the discovery of the dependencies and seeing which sequence that we are going to use for them. And you can either create that or use the default templates, or you could create them based on any data project, or you can just create them manually. So typically what you're going to do is you would be having some data packages. You could group them into a template, for instance, for finance, and then you could add some sales data packages to that and create a template which is called a master legal entity. So there is an easy way of combining things together so that you end up with a template which is convenient for you for doing whatever is necessary. How does it work? Typically, in the user interface, you would create, if we're talking about configuration from one environment to another. So in your source environment, you go into your data management, you would create an export project, and then you would typically use one of the templates, either one that you have created yourself, upload that template, and export the data together for all the entities which were defined in the template and export that data to a local data source. Once you have that data file available in your target environment, you would create an import project. You would load the packages, might add some additional packages and just import it so that you have all the data now into your target system as well. If we're going to copy between legal entities, it's a little bit different. What you would create is you will create a copy project. And basically the first thing you're going to do is in that project, you're going to select where is the source legal entity. So I'm copying, for instance, from my master company template. And then we're going to define what kind of data entities needs to be copied to the target environment, to the target legal entities. So we can do that the same. Typically, I would propose use a custom template for that or a standard template so that you don't have to do too many manual additions. But in case you want, you can add some entities or you can add more templates or you. One of the important things is if you would have maps that you say there are actually a lot of fields that I'm not using, you could even modify those maps. And then typically the next step is you were either going to create some new legal entities where you want to copy the configuration to, or you just will be selecting from existing legal entities. So this can all be done from the same form within the data management workspace. Also the creation of the new legal entities or selecting the legal entities, and then you will just be executing the copy. So the data will be extracted once, and then we will have different jobs which are running can run in parallel for importing the data into the different destination legal entities that you have been selecting. If you say, yeah, there is still a lot of work that needs to be done for creating those data projects, such as the import-export projects, and there's still a possibility that we're making mistakes in that one, we do have something which is called the data task automation. I'm not going to talk too much in detail about it. We have a separated tech talk dedicated to task automation framework. And please have a look to that tech talk if you really want to know all the details. But basically what you can do is we can automate the creation of a data project. We can automate the creation of data packages, creating of a recurring integration. It can connect to LCS and it can import data which is available in your LCS libraries. So if you would upload a golden configuration setup as data packages into your asset library, you could actually automate the full import of that golden configuration in any destination environment. And we do a kind of validation also when we are doing the data migration. So for validation, typically, of course, we're going to make sure that we follow up that jobs that are being created have been executed correctly. We're going to look into the record counts. We're going to look if truncation has happening. Even if you allow truncation, we still will be able to see if something has been truncated. And we're going to look in if you have defined that we should be skipping staging, whether that actually has happened or not. We do have a lot of ideas of what we want to make sure into the future, typically more about what kind of more validations, like we want to make sure that whatever you have been giving as input is exactly the same as output, or maybe you want to even to run some business logic verifying and so on. So there is a lot of things that we still need to be adding to that framework. At this moment, the validation is limited to the first ones, which is the job batch statuses, record counts, truncation, and skip staging. It is quite easy to use. It is you run it from your data management. It is environment agnostic. So typically what you're going to do is you're going to create a manifest file. And in the manifest file, which is an XML file, you're really going to explain where the where we're going to find our data, what kind of import methodology we're going to use, and what kind of data we're going to retrieve. And you're scripting that one, so it's a text file. Since it's a text file, you can put it into your source control. You can have versions of it. If a new version is not working, having a possibility of getting the previous version that was working. And it's really quite easy to define, so there is no coding in it. It's really a kind of just entering data into an XML file and then making sure manifest file gets you load the manifest file into your finance and operation, and also then once you have uploaded the tasks from your manifest file, you can then select them and run them from that workspace into finance and operations. And we do have the validations, which will be displayed in the form after the execution. As I said, there is here a link. If you really want to experiment more, please have a look to that tech talk. Okay. So let's move to the next thing into data management, the database operations. So when we started with finance and operations, most of the tasks which we see as database operations were things that you should request as a service from the DSE team. And it meant that you need to request it. And there was a scheduling time for that for a couple of hours. And then afterwards, a DSE engineer was assigned to the task and was executing it manually. Most of those services have now been becoming available as self-service. And if we're looking to the database movement operations for a tier two and higher, you would find them if you go into the full details of your environment under the maintain button. You have a section move database, and basically you can execute there a refresh database. So copying the data from another environment into this environment. There is a possibility for creating an export of a database. So this will then in the background create a backpack file and upload the backpack file into your asset library. Once you have those backpack files into your asset library, you can then import one from your asset library, which will overwrite your existing environment. You could ask for a point in time restore from a production to a sandbox. So this is a new one with one of the features that was added lately. Typically scenario is something has happened into your production environment which was leading to mistakes, and you want basically to find out how that could happen, and you want to take to a restore of your production before the incident. And of course you don't want to override your production, so you need to copy it into a sandbox, and then you have an environment ready for doing a step-by-step debugging if you execute your operations, what is causing the issue in the environment. And then the last one is the point in time restore. So this is a little bit the same as a rollback, but you need to understand that it is not exactly the same. A point in time restore is just restoring the database to any time point in the last 30 days. But once you have executed that point in time restore, you start with a new database which has the data from that moment, from the moment you have been selecting, but it doesn't have any history any longer. So you cannot ask for a roll forward, or you cannot ask for a new rollback to a timestamp before the creation of this new database. So this is one of the things you need to be very careful of. Also for the refresh database, the refresh database point in time restore, or operations which are creating a new database and creating a new database which starts with a new history. So the old database, including all his history, has been destroyed by those operations. This is for any tier two or higher, so tier 3, 4, and 5, but we're always talking about non-production environments. If we're talking about production environments, then we still need to use the service requests for doing a point in time restore or for copying a sandbox to production. So those two operations, because they will be destroying your existing production environment, we don't offer them as self-service. We're just going to make sure that there is some checks, that you're absolutely sure that you do understand that you're overwriting your production, deleting the existing data and so on. So there is a double check, and that's the reason why you still have to raise a service request, and then a DSE engineer will have some follow-up with you via communications, making sure that everything is fine before executing a destructive operations on your production. So with that, we have covered everything which is not a tier one. For making the picture complete, just want to talk a little bit also about the tier one. So the tier two and above, if you have two tier two environments, user acceptance, data migration, you could just refresh the data migration with data from the user acceptance test. You can do some tests in data migration, doing some validations. If you want to go back into the time that you just have refreshed, you can ask for the point in time restore till that moment. We discussed already that there is a possibility for creating a backpack from a tier two environment. But if we're talking about the tier one or the one box typically used for development, and in some cases people are using them as golden configuration as well, you need to understand that Microsoft is not doing any execution on the tier ones. So if you need to have a backup of the local SQL database, you will have to execute the backup process yourself, make a safeguard of your backup file typically I would not save it on the same tier one environment. I would get it either in my asset library or in on premises. And then if you want to restore it, you can copy the file back to the tier one box and restore it from there. If you need to imagine you have your golden configuration on a tier one box and you need to copy it to the tier two, then you will have to create the backpack file yourself. There is some documentation how to do that. You upload that backpack file into the asset library, and then the import you can do from the tier two. If there is a backpack in the LCS library already, you can download it to the tier one, import it into your local SQL database, and be able to have a copy of the tier two, for instance, golden configuration or test database that you want to give to your developers. But bear in mind, the operations for tier one are operations that either you as customer or you as partner will have to execute yourself. So there is no assistance from Microsoft on those operations. All right. Let's move to the last part of this tech talk, which is the data sharing framework. The data sharing framework, as I mentioned already, is something which is not a replacement for a virtual company. In a virtual company scenario, we would have one record which was visible in different legal entities. This data sharing framework is something new, where we're going to synchronize data from one legal entity to another. So after the synchronization, we will have a record into the first legal entity, and we would have a record into the other legal entities that they are in the same sharing operation. How does it work? We don't do sharing. We will not enable data sharing, or we cannot enable data sharing on any tables. So for that, we have been we're using a framework in which you could define a policy. A policy will include one or more tables, and for each of those tables, we're going to say which fields should be replicated. So it's not the full record that will be replicated. We will really replicating on a field by field. And that gives us, of course, some possibilities. Data is not necessarily for all fields the same, but you still might have some fields that needs to be synchronized. And we're going to specify as last part what legal entities are in scope. So it's bi-directional. So all the legal entities which are in scope, wherever there happens a change, that change will be replicated to the other legal entities which are in scope. The policies, you should not start with defining policies yourself. The policies that are supported are the ones which have been published by Microsoft, and you find those in the shared asset library. If you search into your shared asset library, into your data section, you will see that there are some templates which are available for finance, and there are some templates which are available for supply chain management. You need first to create an import project, and you will be importing those specifications, and then they become available into your cross-company forms. So if you would define environment one, you can have multiple policies, including multiple tables, policy A, policy B, policy C. For making sure, if you would have made some modifications, you might have excluded some of the fields that you don't want to synchronize. So you are allowed to modify the predefined policies by Microsoft. If you want to make sure that you have the same changes in all environments, you would not do that manually, but you could just export via data entities which are available for those policies. You would export it and import it into the other environment, the policy. And of course, the first time the policies will via an import project being imported into your first legal into your first environment. So if we're looking a little bit to the cross-company data sharing, configure cross-company data sharing page, you will be seeing that I have been importing the finance policies that are published today. And I have here on the screen payment days, and you see in the payment days, we have two tables, the payment days and the payment daylines. And you see the fields which are by default synchronized if you would just enable the policy. If you want to make modifications and, for instance, say this description can be different, maybe you want to have the description in a localized language, you could just disable description and it will not be synchronized. And here on the right, you will just be adding all the legal entities that should be sharing the data with each other. So the first step is that you would press the enable button. And once you have pressed enable button, it will run for a while. And basically it will tell you, since you might have data already existing in the entities that you have been selecting, if those legal entities did exist already from the past, there might be some conflicts. You have here a button which is called find sharing issues. You would just press that and the system will be showing you a mismatch, and it has a user interface which allows you to select which of the records you're going to use as master. And once you have finalized all those sharing issues, that's the moment that the policy will be running. There is, as I mentioned already, some limitations. So definitely we will not enable, you cannot enable for transactional data. So it's meant typically for master data or reference data, but typically the kind of information which is static and is can be shared across different legal entities. Also, there is a limitation at the moment for each job. We should not go about synchronizing more than 200 million records. So this would be the number of shared records multiplied by the number of companies that are enabled into the sharing. We do have enabled also now the sharing for customer and vendor, but at this moment this is still something that that needs to be reviewed before, and you need to get an approval before we will activating it for you. The reason is, as I mentioned before, there is limitations. Typically it's not suited for high volumes which are way above those 2 million. So before this feature can be enabled in your implementation for customer and vendor, don't forget to look into the docs page. You find them into the presentation at the resources in the end of this presentation, and make sure that you fill in the form for asking that approval. Think about if you would have a lot of data, that it makes sense for first importing the data into your seeding company before you activate the sharing policy, because otherwise we would start doing a replication record by record if you would be inserting data. And if you wait for enabling the data policy till all the data has been populated, it will be able to replicate via bulk mechanism, which is way faster. For customers who are live already, as I mentioned already, it would be a three-step phase. You would have data in legal entity one, data in legal entity two. There might be discrepancies, so you enable. Then you would first see if there are conflicts. You would refresh, you would fix those replication issues, make sure you select which one will be the dominant one, and then once everything is all conflicts has been resolved, you're really having a system which is synchronized and doesn't have any wrong data. As a last reminder, we do have in the data sharing two buttons which are saying update or disable. Update scenario would typically B, you have already a synchronization between two or three legal entities, existing legal entities, and you want to add one legal entity to it. So what you would do is you just add the one legal entity, you press on an update. But in this mean at that time, it means that the data synchronization has always been on. So you're absolutely sure that you will not be missing any data. The other one is the disable one, and that's the one that you have to be very careful if you want to enable it later on, that this will really stop the synchronization trigger. Typically, you would use that in a scenario where you want to add additional fields to the policies, some that you have been switched off earlier and you still want to do it. But you must make sure that you only do that disable and enabling whether you have a complete lockdown of the system. So you don't want to have data inserted while you have the policy disabled. That would mean if you do so and you have you have records which are inserted in one of the tables which is belonging to the policy, after enabling it, it will not synchronize that record, and that might end, and you might end up with data which is not in sync. All right, that was it for me. As I mentioned on the last slide, you see a lot of references. So for any of the topics that I have been discussing on a high level, if you need to have some more details, please have a look in these references and you will find additional information. Eric, that's it. Is there any question that you want to bring up and also the answer which might be interesting for the whole audience?
I think that have been, for the most part, just regular questions, so I don't think I have anything to share right now.
No. So if we don't have any additional question, then I would say...
Hang on one second. Yeah, well, there was one question about the video, and yes, the video for the Tech Talk will be published in a few days.
Yeah, and you'll find it on the same link that you have been using for attending this Tech Talk. Okay, with that, then I would thank you for your time and wish you a pleasant continuation of the day.
Thank you, Mark. If everyone could please draw their attention to the chat window where I have posted a short survey. Our presenters value your feedback and would greatly appreciate you taking a moment to fill out the survey. The survey scores are on a scale from 1 to 5, with 5 being the highest score possible. It takes like 3 minutes. It's great. We really appreciate it. The recording and a copy of the presentation deck will be available within 5 business days. Please look for an email from Worldwide Learning that will include details on how to access them. I'd like to thank our presenters and, of course, thank the audience, you guys, for logging in and joining us today. This concludes today's event.